Jasper Johns may be the most important American artist of our times. From his first show in 1958, he has been one of the major forces in modern art. His art is accessible, yet full of nuance and mystery. Ordinary objects, rethought and reborn. Riddles of abstraction. Riddles of representation. And through it all, a consistent thread.
There's probably very few people you could name who haven't been touched by Jasper. And not so much as doing what Jasper does, but being influenced by how Jasper thinks about what he does.
$6,400,000. Telephone bidder against you all in here, fair warning, at $6,400,000. Telephone bidder.
In recent years, the value of John's work has risen to staggering heights. He now commands the highest prices of any living artist in the world. Is his art the ultimate commodity in a materialistic society, or is it really exceptional? Not everyone thinks so.
You see, I look upon John's career as being pretty much a downhill slide from a very not terribly high point to begin with.
John's circle has included some of the most important creative figures in American life. People like painter Robert Rauschenberg, composer John Cage, and choreographer Merce Cunningham.
The experience can give you a different kind of sense about what life is about. And certainly Jasper's way of looking at things has done that for many of us.
I had a book which you could put alongside Finnegan's Wake, and line for line, it would explain the mysteries of Finnegan's Wake. But once they're explained, the book itself remains just as mysterious.
I like what I see to be real, or to be my idea of what is real. And I think I have a kind of resentment against illusion when I can recognize it.
In the process of painting a picture, Johns does not feel that he is providing every answer. In fact, the painting itself is asking a question as much as it's providing an answer.
Also, a large part of my work has been involved with the painting as object, as real thing in itself. And in the place of that tragedy, so far, my general development has moved in the direction of using real things as painting.
We may have to edit this out, but I mean, Jasper's a classic kind of dauber, and I like the daubing, and sort of because it's like getting into the painting. I mean, to me, it's a kind of sort of, I don't know, you could say very sophisticated or very unsophisticated version of finger painting.
He once painted the flag, which made him notorious, but in fact, his work is very difficult. Quite conservative, except technically where it is very experimental.
At times, I will attempt to do something which seems quite uncalled for in the painting, so that the work won't proceed so logically from where it is, but will go somewhere else. My experience of life is that it's very fragmented. In one place, certain kinds of things occur, and in another place, a different kind of thing occurs. I would like my work to have some vivid indication of those differences.
What? It's 2 1/8 inches. I don't want my work to be an exposure of my feelings.
Time Magazine, 1959. Jasper Johns, 29, is the brand new darling of the art world's bright, brittle avant-garde. A year ago, he was practically unknown. Since then, he has had a sellout show in Manhattan and has exhibited in Paris and Milan. Something remarkable happened at Johns' first show. Alfred Barr, the guiding light of New York's Museum of Modern Art, bought three of his paintings for the museum, an unprecedented honor for a young artist. Venice, 1988. 3 decades later, Jasper Johns has emerged as the preeminent American painter and printmaker. The Philadelphia Museum presents his work as the American entry to the Venice Biennale, one of the world's most prestigious art events. Johns is awarded the grand prize. Time magazine now compares him to Rembrandt.
It seemed obvious that that was going to happen to Jasper. You know, it didn't seem obvious to me that it would happen to me. And, who cared about those kind of things? I mean, it wasn't really interesting. I mean, making the paintings was what you cared about.
One would like not to be led. Avoid the idea of a puzzle which could be solved. Remove the signs of thought. It is not thought which needs showing.
Making art is the center of Jasper Johns' life. That is all that can easily be said about him. When one tries to establish a fix on why he creates or what his art means, there are no simple answers.
There may or may not be an idea, and the meaning may just be that the painting exists. And then, like anything, disturbs people or calms people, or what they find, some people find something to do with it. It's in the space in which they are, and they react to it as they would to anything else.
Although the man and his art are elusive, his effect on those around him is hard to miss. there is a noticeable tension in the air when he enters the U.S. galleries in Venice. This is John's first major show in 13 years. He is nervous, concerned, focused on every little detail.
Why can't it be done today? Why can't things be put in the wall today so that whenever we have the picture, we can decide which goes where? They're the same size.
Most art historians think that artists create the way art historians write. But finally, it comes down to the making of the object and making it as beautiful, as disturbing, as this, as that, as possible that the artist is trying to achieve. And that is the case with John's. And at one point I asked him what are his great ambitions, and he said something to the effect that simply to make each thing I do well.
We say one thing is not another thing, or sometimes we say it is, or we say they are the same.
So looked at the name under the painting, and it said Jasper Johns, a name that I had never heard before.
And at that time, when I first saw it, I did not understand that it was a target.
But as luck would have it, a few days later, I went to Rauschenberg's studio, and then Rauschenberg said, that we wanted to have a drink, perhaps, while we were looking at his painting, and he didn't have an icebox, but Jasper Johns on the floor below had one.
I couldn't wait to see his painting and asked Bob whether we could not interrupt the proceedings there at his studio and go down to Jasper's studio and see what he was doing.
So, good guy that Rauschenberg was, he said, fine, let's go. And so he went down. And then I was confronted with that miraculous array of unprecedented images.
Castelli offered Johns his first show on the spot and has represented him ever since.
One night I dreamed I painted a large American flag, and the next morning I got up and I went out and bought materials to begin it. Because some things I stitched onto the canvas with thread. It's a very rotten painting because I began it in like house enamel paint, and it wouldn't dry quick enough. And then I had in my head this idea of something I had read, I heard, I don't know what, about wax and caustic. And I changed in the middle of the painting to that because the encaustic just has to cool, and then it's hard, and you don't blur it again.
Johns described his flags and targets as things the mind already knows. A stark contrast with the art of the abstract expressionists, whose images could be read as emotional Rorschach tests.
The people who followed and did imitation abstract expressionism were fairly boring. And there was a hiatus, there was a dull moment there in American art, and there was a longing, there was a need for something to happen.
Johns proposed a cooler alternative, using real things as a point of departure, but only as a formal device.
The paintings that followed immediately, which were paintings of targets and numbers, gave me the same opportunity to feel removed from the work, neutral toward it, involved in the making, but not involved in the judging of it.
The activity of making, just the process, was preeminent in Jasper. And the results seemed like they would take care of itself once the supposition was stated, whether it was going to be a map or a target or whatever. Then it gave him a great freedom to intensely follow the program within the limitation that he set for himself.
It doesn't just refer to things which are images, but even ways of doing things within a painting, ways of painting. If it occurs to me that there is a way of painting that I can introduce into my work that I have not used before, that somehow I will become a more skillful artist. I don't know that that's true at all.
He had taken painting to the last place it could go, really. I mean, you know, by using essentially two-dimensional objects and flattening them out and then realizing that they weren't that flat, and the wax helped to dispel the idea that they were that flat. But those images were so arresting and so beautifully done. I mean, other people have done that, but it never worked.
Johns has also been playing, really, from the start. You look at those Ballantine ale cans, that painted bronze, and is it a still life? You know, is it a joke? Is it a monument? Is it to be to fool your eye or not? And you find these kind of paradoxical questions at the core of almost everything Johns has done.
I heard that Bill de Kooning had said about Leo, with whom he was annoyed over something, that son of a bitch, you could give him two beer cans and he could sell them. And at that time, I had made a couple of sculptures. I'd made one or two of a flashlight and one or two of a light bulb. And when I heard this story, I thought, what a fantastic sculpture for me. I mean, really, just absolutely perfect. So I made this work. I did it, and Leo sold it.
Two artists were at the center of this artistic revolution that rejected abstraction in favor of real images. While Jasper Johns opted for detachment, making us see ordinary things in new ways, his friend Robert Rauschenberg combined highly charged images because of their meanings. Their art signaled the end of the dominance of abstract art in America and laid the groundwork for both pop art and minimalism.
I mean, Rothko, I remember, was extremely depressed and felt almost humiliated that people who had bought his paintings would have such bad taste as to buy Johns or Rauschenberg or Andy Warhol.
It was a terrifically elegant razzle-dazzle affair, and Jasper, as I remember, he had on white tie and teals. He likes to dress high style. And there were bunches of these dowages and evening gowns draped with jewels there. And it was this occasion that I connect that story, and I have the impression that I actually heard this. And it's typical of him that he, one of these dowagers was cross-questioning him, and she said, well, Mr. Johns, I know you come from the old South, and I assume you come from an old plantation family. And he looked her straight in the eye and said, no, ma'am, I'm poor white trash.
My work feeds upon thee is to use. My work has something else to it, a constant negation of myself and partly due to my feelings. Place, a different kind of thing occurs. I include them. Deluge has state with paint. Rub it while, but o'er the mirror, canvas. In my early work, I tried to hide my personality, my psychological state. My recognize it all.
Jasper Johns grew up in Allendale, South Carolina, a small country town.
Back there when Jasper was here, it was such a small town. You went out to play and you didn't even have to say where you were going because everybody took care of you.
Jasper's grandfather, W.I. Johns, a prosperous farmer, had been one of the founders of Allendale County.
And Jasper used to come home with me from school, and Granddaddy'd pick him up after supper. That was after he was old enough to go to school, because he came to his grandfather when he was two.
After his parents separated, Jasper's home was his grandfather's old brick house. Both parents lived a few blocks away.
Not a life statement, it has to be what you can't avoid. A deliberate, helpless statement. It has to be final. The deliberate statement has to be what you can't avoid saying. I think that life, the sense of life, the final statement, has to be what you can't avoid saying. I think that one wants from a painting a sense of life, the final suggestion, life. The final you can't statement has one wants, it has to be what you sense of life. Final suggestion, the final statement, has to be a deliberate but, a deliberate can't. Avoid saying I be.
It had been my intention to be an artist since I was a child. And in the place where I was a child, there were no artists, so I didn't, and there was no art, so I really didn't know what that meant. And I think it meant that I would be able to be in a situation other than the one that I was in. I think that was the primary fantasy. Whereas the society there seemed to accommodate every other thing I knew about, but not that possibility. So I think that in part the idea of being an artist was that kind of fantasy of being out of this. Then, because there's none of this here, so if you're going to be it, you'll have to be somewhere else.
Johns arrived in New York in the early 50s. He was working as a night clerk at Marlboro Books when he first met Robert Rauschenberg, a somewhat more established but still starving artist. One of the things the two did to support themselves was creating window displays.
Well, the concept was nature mort, still lifes. And having just gotten a book on famous still lives, I thought, gee, that'd make wonderful windows for Tiffany. I was new at Tiffany. This happened, I think, in 56. And who else to do it except Bob and Jasper, you know? Well, with Bob and Jasper, you see, I wasn't showing their serious work, really. They were creating display things for me. And that, to me, is very serious work. Is not serious enough to other artists, I suppose. But I think one influences the other. It can't help it. You know, what you are comes out, and whatever you do, it doesn't matter whether you're doing windows or a painting.
There was one thing that they were doing in which they took a big cassava melon. They made it out of stuff, and it looked like somebody had taken a knife and whacked it. And then they put it in Tiffany's windows with diamonds and jewels hanging all over it.
I wanted him to cast everything in dimension and then give it a painterly quality. And so they did. They cast real pomegranates. They cast the open pomegranate. They looked so real, it was unbelievable. They looked as real as they do in the painting.
They really collaborated.
And I don't know who did what. It's, you know, exactly as those flowers. I don't know why I say Jasper. But I just immediately think of Jasper when I look at those flowers. I don't know, maybe Bob did them. But I have a feeling Jasper did them.
They were great windows, but after John's first successful shows, window design wasn't needed to pay the rent.
Originally, with the targets and flags and so forth, one could say that one wasn't interested in the subjects, but one was interested in the painting. But now we're in the position having to say that we're interested in everything.
John's is largely a self-taught artist. Of much more importance than a formal education were the friendships that he developed early in his career with a group of talented artists.
There was a period in my life where Merce, John, and Bob Rauschenberg and I were very close. And we all were together very often. And since all three of them were and are artists that I admire very highly, I look to them for probably for ideas, but also and for approval of what I did. John being the most sort of teachy member of the group, and probably having a clearer understanding of all the different mediums involved that we were all using. He was of extreme importance to me at that time.
While Cage's work has moved from traditional composition to performances based on chance, John's continues to create his art through intense struggle.
Okay, so I have to hit it just to the right.
Well, you see, I think often in my choices, I go through a kind of a process of psychological disturbance that would be very offensive to John, and he would find it absolutely foolish. Not and worse than foolish, offensive, I believe. But that allows for immediately a complexity in one way or another. And I think that very thing appealed to me, to my eye, to my sense of the way I look at a painting right from the beginning. And I think perhaps it's because in my own work, I have a tendency to deal in complexity rather than so to speak, simple things involving dancing, involving movement.
In the late 60s, John served as the artistic advisor for the Cunningham Dance Company. His target image is still the company's emblem. He created costumes and sets for a number of works, including Walk Around Time, which also paid homage to another of his artistic sources of inspiration, Marcel Duchamp. The set for Walk Around Time is based on the Duchamp composition Large Glass. It was Rauschenberg who took John's to the Philadelphia Museum to see their Duchamp collection. Marcel Duchamp was a well-known cubist painter when his nude descending a staircase shocked the art world in 1913. During the First World War, Duchamp was one of the founders of the anti-art movement known as Dada. art was a question of definition. If one said it was art, it was.
My God, painting the American flag, I mean, it's sort of the ultimate Dada gesture. Or painting a flag of the United States. I mean, this reintroduced a certain element of what you can call the absurd from Dada, and what I would call a certain element of nihilism.
My Aunt Gladys once, when she read a thing in a magazine, wrote me a letter saying she was so proud of me because she had worked so hard to instill some respect for the American flag in her students. And she was so glad that the mark had been left on me.
When Duchamp called ordinary things works of art, he was making an assault on the very nature of art. John seems more interested in ambiguity and transformation when he works with everyday objects.
There's one period in which he was studying Duchamp's notes for the large glass very carefully, and he did sketchbook notes. And he does from time to time do sketchbook notes, but not very often. I mean, things will mainly arise out of an encounter with something that provokes him.
Duchamp has obviously aroused John's interest. The Mona Lisa alludes to Duchamp's Mona Lisa satire, and Duchamp's own profile shows up in John's paintings. John's is also interested in the ideas of philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, who felt that the world could be defined by logic and precise language. Wittgenstein talked about pictures as models of reality, suggesting that their elements should be related in the same way that real things are. Both Johns and Wittgenstein are attracted to areas where logic breaks down, where things seem real but are not. Wittgenstein says, "I am shown the duck rabbit and asked what it is. I may say, it's a duck rabbit. But I may also react to the question quite differently. Had I replied, it's a rabbit, the ambiguity would have escaped me." Jasper John's art has involved a subtle and continuous shifting of ground. There would be a series of paintings whose primary focus was the brushstrokes, the colors, the juxtapositions, the sorts of things that emerge when an artist focuses on the physical process of painting. But John's is just as interested in working with ideas and associations. In these paintings, the observer is invited to try to follow the artist's thought process and understand his intentions.
Sometimes you will have an idea when you have a painting, whereas you had no idea before you had a painting. Sometimes there's a very clear image established ahead of time and you simply have to execute it. Sometimes you want to engage in a kind of activity and see what it'll produce.
John's painted in the studio in 1982.
I had seen an empty canvas propped against a painting in my studio. And that accounts for the sort of empty rectangle that goes in a slight perspective. I had some wax casts of an arm of a child, three-dimensional object in relation to this representation of space in the canvas. There's a strip of wood that comes out from the surface of the painting. I was playing with that kind of thought on one level of real things in space and suggestion of things in space. And the suggestion of space. And within it, within the studio setting, the representation of paintings, one of which, at least one of which, is melting. So in a kind of setting where there are just a few elements, there was the suggestion that something was happening, I thought.
While this was going on, Jasper was cooking a fish.
Sculptor Richard Serra's first commission came from Johns, who saw a piece he created at the Whitney Museum by splashing molten lead against the juncture of a wall and the floor. Johns invited him to do a similar work in his studio.
He was also opening his mail, and he was also painting on a painting, a target, a green, purple, and orange target, and seeing to the daily business of his studio. At one point, he picked up a ladder, and he walked to the ventilator, the window vent, climbed up the ladder, opened the window, climbed back down, put the ladder under his arm, and started to walk back toward the kitchen. I asked him how long he had been painting on the painting. He said 8 years. Then he came back once again to deposit something in an anteroom. And I asked if he liked doing that, and he said, which part?
Racing Thoughts, 1984.
I had had a period of kind of anxiety, I suppose, where I was, when I was trying to go to sleep, images and bits of images and bits of thoughts would run through my head without any connectedness that I could see. And I was having dinner with a psychologist that I had met. And I explained that I had been having this for like a week, this situation. And he said, oh, we call those racing thoughts. And I was very pleased that there was a name for my condition.
Johns began a series of four paintings called The Seasons. The seasons of the year combine with the seasons of human life, infancy, youth, maturity, and old age. The young Johns had said, I don't want my work to be an exposure of my feelings. The mature artist, looking back, admits, eventually it seemed like a losing battle. Finally, one must simply drop the reserve. Full of the accumulation of a lifetime, the strongest indication of the painting's personal nature is the appearance of a figure. Ghostly, cut in two, or fading away into the ruins of the past.
Well, they reflect a different kind of rhythm because they're fairly complicated in terms of imagery, suggesting almost a kind of natural abundance of detail, that they are cyclical in terms of, you know, in traditional terms, gives them a sense of wholeness, I guess. They have that to a degree that not much of my work has. How's that?
The way Johns reworks themes and images is much more a tradition in printmaking than in painting.
This one too.
One talks of the first state of a print, the second state, and so forth, with the understanding that printmaking is a process of refining and redefining images. Over the years, Johns has created hundreds of lithographs and etchings that explore the same subjects and objects as his paintings and sculpture. He has learned to use the unique characteristics of each medium to its fullest. Drawing or painting on a smooth limestone is the basis of lithography. The surface captures the crayon's rough texture and the subtle nuances of the artist's ink. Rich effects can be created by printing many layers of images. Almost every major painting has its counterpart in John's prints. These are the color etchings of the seasons. Then, John's took the plates used to print the black ink on the color print and completely reworked and rearranged them to create a new print. After the edition of the black and white seasons was printed, John's returned to the plates again to rework them yet another time. 3 years have now passed since he began working on these sheets of polished copper. In etching, the artist uses acid to etch lines and patterns on a metal plate. It can also be a very physical process, sanding and scraping the metal to create or remove textures and images. Johns has even punched holes in plates with nail punches.
Keeping all the marks, the history of everything is contained.
Both etching and lithography are curiously old-fashioned and low-tech. It takes a great deal of experience to make the process work, so even experienced artists like John's usually work with master printers. Although John's works with others, he has rarely collaborated with other artists. In 1983, he created a set of prints, and Samuel Beckett provided the text for the book Fizzles. Words, one of the first prints in the series, mirrors the overlapping layers of the dense and obsessive text.
It was he who wailed, he who saw the light. I didn't wail. I didn't see the light. It's impossible I should have a voice. Impossible I should have thoughts. And I speak and think. I do the impossible. It is not possible otherwise. It was he who had a life. I didn't have a life. A life not worth having. Because of me, he'll do himself to death. Because of me, I'll tell the tale. The tale of his death. The end of his life and his death. His death alone would not be enough. Not enough for me. If he rattles, it's he who will rattle. I won't rattle. He who will die, I won't die. Perhaps they'll bury him. If they find him, I'll be inside. He'll rot. I won't rot. I'll be inside. It's not possible. That's how I see it.
there always seemed to be another content residing in the work. And I still, and I think that's not only still apparent, but even more so, particularly with paintings like Perilous Night. I mean, it really gets into the pain beneath the surface, the scratching on the blackboard.
In 1943, John Cage wrote a piece of music called The Perilous Night.
The first title for that piece came from an Irish myth. It's not called The Perilous Night, it's called The Perilous Bed. And I was at the point of divorce between Xenia and Cage and when I wrote it, and it was the dark side of the erotic. It presents a situation that is where the extremes become, well, where things were together, that they come go far apart.
In the legend, the perilous bed rested on a floor of polished jasper.
I could have your attention, ladies and gentlemen, please. Before I begin, I must just read the customary announcements. Bidders are reminded that...
John's art is immensely valuable. There is a list of people waiting to buy anything with his name on it. Since early in his career, his art has sold for prices that have broken record after record. In 1988, Diver sold for $4.1 million at auction, setting a new record for the work of a living artist.
$3 million, $3,200,000.
That record stood until November of 1988, when Christie's auctioned White Flag, a painting that originally sold for $2,000.
$4,200,000, $4,500,000, $4,800,000, $4,800,000, $5 million, $5,200,000, $5,500,000, $5,800,000. It is this side at $5,800,000 against two left. At $6 million on the telephone. Six million. What's that? Two? One. All right, $6,000,001 ahead of your bidder. I'll take 6-2. No, $6,000,001 is against you. In the room. and against the gallery too. 6,100,000, 6,200,000 on the telephone, 6,300,000 in the room, 6,300,000, 6,400,000 on the telephone. No? One more, sir? Really not? $6,400,000 on the telephone, and against your bid, and against the room, at $6,400,000. The telephone bidder against you all in here, fair warning, at $6,400,000. Telephone bidder, $6,400,000.
The 10% auction commission brought the price of the painting to a little over $7 million. That record only lasted one day. The following day, this painting, False Start, sold for $17 million at another auction at Sotheby's.
I don't think I fully understand it, the process. When it begins, you're pleased that you can make something and sell it. It allows you to devote yourself to the work that you want to do. As it expands and the value of the work increases, at a certain point you see that the society takes over in the determination of the value of the work and the meaning of the work.
Scarcity is also something that's very important. There are not many Jasper Johnses around, so competition always among collectors plays an important role.
Art has taken the place of precious metals in the economy, and it has never done that to the degree that it has today. And so you have this extremely distorted point of view. People are really, they are not talking about art, they are talking about money. So that to think that they're talking about art is, I think, the first misconception.
$900,000. Fair warning. So for $900,000. You again, sir, $900,000.
If you look at it, it just looks like a bunch of marks all over the place. But Jasper Johns actually did this very carefully with a lot of planning.
If you see something and it intrigues you in any way, even to the point of horrible irritation, go back and look at it again. Don't worry about being educated. I think that most of the time gets in the way, from my point of view.
I personally think that his work can be fully appreciated without knowing what the hell it's about at all, because it's incredibly good painting.
I'm really impressed. I like these a lot.
Because it makes you, like, imagine stuff. You can see stuff within paintings.
I mean, I didn't want to know too much about the ideas because I didn't think I would be that interested in them. But I loved the paintings, and there was something about them.
Well, I think they're really interesting because he takes all different things and puts them together into one big picture.
I think he paints as well as he ever painted. He has that beautiful touch. But while he has not forgotten how to paint, in some way, he seems to me to have forgotten what to paint.
I like the way he uses the color and sort of flashes it together.
Well, I like the Four Seasons the best because he shows like his lifetime and how he goes, gets older, and how he dies.
I think Jasper's a fairly conventional person, and sort of a conventional artist in the best sense of the word. I mean, it's sort of, you know, that's what, you know, I mean, art is about conventions, I guess, in a way, and then trying to make expand the conventions so that they're expressive, and that's what he does the best.
To the degree that I have been influenced or moved by other people's work, I probably have an idea that perhaps someone might have that kind of use for my pictures.
the question of what is entity splitting on the psychological level, but also the question of what is apart, and what the question of what is apart, and what is a whole, is a very ordinary infantile level. Yes, level, but also in ordinary objective space is a very interesting problem on the question of what is a question of what is a part, a very part, and what is a whole is a very interesting problem on the psychological level, but also in ordinary is.